FBI report, June 12th, 1964. Anonymous caller at 140 says Malcolm X will be bumped off.
America's whole situation is a lunatic fringe. Anytime you have a country that refers to itself as the free world and a democracy, and at the same time has 22 million of its citizens who aren't permitted citizenship, why, that in itself reflects lunacy, a collective lunacy on the part of Uncle Sam. And you almost have to be insane to deal with an insane man or an insane situation.
I met him just a week or so before he died at an airport. And he told me there that he had a telephone call with Martin Luther King, and they were going to meet and try to amalgamate their two forces, his Organization of Afro-American Unity and Martin's Southern Christian Leadership Conference, and sort of divide the country into North and South, Martin in the South and Malcolm in the North. It would have been a great movement with these two charismatic men. And I think the government had to stop that at any cost.
The day that Malcolm was assassinated, February 21st, 1965.
I have never seen him with the kind of expression that he had on his face and in his being.
I went to the Audubon with my son, Billy. He hero worshiped Malcolm. When we went there, we couldn't help but feel there was something in the air. I wouldn't know how to pinpoint it, but there seemed to be a lot of anxiety.
Don't think that I don't know how bad I make myself look by attacking an organization that I was once so inseparably a part of. But I'm not particularly concerned with how bad it makes me look. My prime concern is to expose it to the fullest of my ability. Let the chips fall where they may.
Well, we all went to the meeting, and I had my children with me, and we were sitting in the front, facing the sides of the Audubon, not facing the back looking front.
Benjamin got up on the stage, and he started to speak. And usually I take notes, and I still have the notes I took then, and I'll read some excerpts. Anyone opening the door will face life or death. We must not care for personal consequences. Such a person is a good man who would put concern for others.
When the last thing I said was, I now bring before you a man who would give his life for his people.
Just after he said that, there was a commotion in the middle of the room, and there was a distraction when two men seemed to jumped up, and one said, "Get your hands out of my pocket." And everybody, of course, had turned to look at these two men. And just then, it seemed like shots were fired from the front.
I had four children, and I threw their bodies underneath the bench and covered them with my body. And it was my oldest daughter who said she could not breathe, you know. And so that I kind of moved slightly so that she could get some air and breathe. And as I moved, kind of raised my head, and I saw someone gasping like something horrible was happening. And I looked to the front to see my husband falling back.
Then it was like all hell broke loose. And a young brother passed me on the aisle. And so I told my son, stay here. And I followed him because I knew he must be going up to the stage, and I wanted to know how Malcolm was doing. And I got up there, and I went to Malcolm. He was breathing heavily, and I put his head on my lap, and other people came and they opened his shirt, and you could see that he was shot all over.
Elijah Muhammad Jr. stood up and told the crew, many of whom are here now also, that I should have been killed that my tongue should have been put in an envelope and sent back to Chicago by now.
Well, Malcolm X is a great man. There's many different Malcolms, and people just are inspired by what he did, what he stood for.
Malcolm X, the movie, is making its world premiere. It's a star-studded affair, but tonight's real star is a man who died 28 years ago.
When he was alive, I think that for a lot of people, he made black pride scary, frightening, you know, because it was a very anti-American conception of black pride.
The injustice that has been inflicted upon Negroes in this country by Uncle Sam is criminal. Don't blame a cracker in Georgia for your injustices. The government is responsible for the injustices.
Tonight's star is a former criminal, reborn in prison as Malcolm X.
Malcolm X already is an American hero. And by that, I mean that African Americans do not have to wait. We don't need America's stamp of approval.
Starlight dimmed on the eve of Black Pride, Black Panthers, and Black Power.
In real political terms, I think that, again, things like the LA riots, the disappearance of so much civil rights legislation, the resegregation, and in fact, the statistics show that blacks in particular, but people of color generally, are worse off than they were in some categories than at the beginning of the civil rights movement. I think all of this has produced a certain kind of quest for something like a messiah.
During the Great War, a woman from the Caribbean bought a ticket to the U.S. She believed in that delicate line separating life from death, the line of color. Her name was Louise Norton, Malcolm's mother. There, she married Earl Little, a Baptist preacher.
One thing that might help in understanding Malcolm is to know that in our family background, we were always activists. The two heroes that we were taught to look up to, these were the two that my father always liked, was Marcus Garvey and Booker T. Washington.
Louise and Earl were members of Garvey's United Negro Improvement Association, formed in 1914 to promote unity among people of African descent.
When we were in, I think it was Milwaukee, there was a time when Marcus Garvey was, they were attempting to deport him. In fact, they did deport him eventually. But he came through and stayed with us. We couldn't tell anybody that he was there at the time.
At the time, Louise was pregnant, and Earl said, "That will be my seventh child." Seven, said Louise, is the number of vision.
The influences of his mother were of enormous significance. She was very well educated at the time she migrated to North America, grounded in the three R's in an Anglican school in Grenada, and politically committed.
My earliest recollection of my childhood is of being snatched awake in the middle of the night because our house was on fire. The lancing arm of the Ku Klux Klan warned my father to stop preaching Garvey's message.
The events that shaped him were such compelling and, in fact, dramatic events. And they speak to racial issues in America. They have a kind of, they aren't metaphors, they are direct encounters with racism in America.
My father was not a frightened Negro, and he kept on. Next thing, he was found with his head bashed in, lying across the streetcar tracks. The Christian people of Lansing wouldn't hire the widow of a crazy nigger.
There were people who worked for the Social Services Agency at that time, also the probate judge, who wanted the probate judge wanted the property, and eventually it did end up with his family, some members of his family. But what they would do was put undue pressures on, they would harass her. They would come all hours of the day and night and just come walking in and claim they had a right to because they were the ones that were furnishing assistance. And did everything they could to demean her and keep her continuously feeling ill at ease. And over a period of time, this began to affect her.
Louise was locked up in a mental institution, and her children made wards of the court. Malcolm lost interest in school when they told him wanting to be a lawyer was not a realistic goal for a nigger. He went from foster home to foster home, till he went to live in Boston with his half-sister, Ella. He was 13.
I met Malcolm X in a pool room on Humboldt Avenue up in Roxbury, Massachusetts. He was dressed real sharp with his wide-brimmed hat, zoot suit, big leg pants with the fancy chain, knob-toe shoes. And I had the impression that he was a slickster from New York.
The way Malcolm tells his story to Alex Haley, the zoot suit culture and the conch, everything that he participated in during the war, during his youth, was seen as a period of darkness, sort of political darkness for him. The Nation of Islam is the thing that sort of politicized him in his prison experiences. And what I would suggest is that the zoot suit was a very politicized suit of clothing. Those who wore the zoot suit themselves were seen as able-bodied young men who refused to participate in the war.
New York was heaven, and Harlem was seventh heaven. When Uncle Sam finally caught up with me, I told the psychiatrist I couldn't wait to get my hands on a gun so I could shoot me some crackers.
Walking around, flaunting both the zoot suit, which went against war production codes, and flaunting the fact that they ought to be in the army but refused to go, was itself a direct statement, a kind of embodiment of anti-patriotism at the time.
One night, one of the girls got bored and said, oh, let's go break in somebody's house for some kicks and some excitement. So this way, Beatrice was the one that used to say, well, there's Mr. Procter and Mr. Gamble, who used to be the owners of the Procter & Gamble soap in those days. Well, Mr. Gamble, she says, he only lives a couple of blocks away, and he's down in Florida on his winter vacation. We can go in his house. So what we did, we got the phone number, we made a phone call, there was nobody answered the phone. And then we went over and we looked at the house was dark. We rang the Malcolm would go up and ring the front door bell to make sure there was nobody there. When nobody's there, we took a crowbar and entered the house through the window.
Those problems with the breakup of a family or the attraction to drugs, the hustling life, the ritual or rite of passage of going to jail are statistically incredibly common right now. And so I think that story actually has a wider audience, and an audience that understands much more the need for a personal transformation.
The war is over. And as Malcolm enters prison, African-American servicemen come home to a fanfare of blowtorch killings, eye gougings, and lynchings. And to a Harlem family, on August the 7th, a seventh son is born. They name him Gabriel Prosser. Remember the name, for in time, Malcolm and Gabriel's paths will cross.
After Malcolm got caught in some of his wrongdoing, and he got sentenced to prison, it was a kind of a shock to him, but it was something that he needed. He needed that. In fact, I even felt relieved when he was arrested and put in prison, because I was afraid that any day I might be notified that he'd been shot by the police or something.
We both received what is known as 8 to 10 years, which means, according to the law, we each had to serve a minimum of 60 months, which is 5 years in prison.
After they had sentenced him, I talked with him and I told him then, I said, you know, you didn't finish school. You got all this time to do. So let the time serve you instead of you serving it.
We were seeking knowledge and wisdom of the world. Now, what we were seeking went way beyond our normal studies. So we went into practicing mental telepathy. Now, this may sound foolish to some people, but it is a possibility and it has happened, and we touch base with it. Now, all this has to do with Malcolm's transformation of his mind, building it to the point where he was strong enough where he could hypnotize an audience through the way he spoke to them.
We're loving people. We love everybody who loves us. But we don't love anybody who doesn't love us. We're nonviolent with people who are nonviolent with us. But we are not nonviolent with anyone who is violent with us.
I became aware of a Muslim group who were doing things similar to what we had done in the UNIA. So when I heard about that, I got involved with them. And once I did, then I brought in my brothers and sisters who were in the area into it. Malcolm had a time accepting the Islam when he first heard about it. But I had a younger brother, Reginald, who had been on the streets with Malcolm, and they understood each other. So I sent Reginald to him to visit him in prison, and Reginald is the one who convinced him.
As I lay in my bed, I suddenly became aware of a man sitting beside me in my chair. I looked right into his face. I knew I wasn't dreaming. I didn't speak, and he didn't. Then, suddenly as he had come, he was gone.
I knew he had the ability to become a big person once he got out of prison. You see, when he was in prison, he was like a bird in a gilded cage. He was dying to get out, and once they opened the door to let him out, he became dangerous. Now, you know the old saying, a thinking man is a dangerous man. Malcolm taught himself to be a thinking man. He became so dangerous, he became a threat to the men of power.
...1952. The first time in 70 years, no lynchings. A student named Martin Luther King thought nonviolence a sham. And Malcolm received his X from a man who was once a corporal in his mother's organization.
We have come to hear and to see the greatest and the wisest and most fearless black man in America today.
Malcolm's relationship with Mr. Muhammad was almost a form of worship. He saw him as a father image.
As a matter of fact, he called him my son, you know. And at 6 years old, I guess, losing his father and losing him tragically, it was like having a father again.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad has set up more businesses than any black man in America. He's not trying to build churches, he's trying to build businesses.
because businesses make jobs for you, and churches don't make jobs for anybody but preachers.
He worked very hard. When he entered that movement, they had four, they called them temples, not over six, populated by very elderly members. And in a very short time, they had temples all over the United States and outside of the United States, populated primarily with young adults.
They're passing the basket through the crowd. I think everybody standing here should put $1 in that basket. Don't you think you should? Sure, these are freedom dollars, brother.
African Square, the home of the revolutionary thinking of Harlem. On this corner stood Herbie's Diamond Store. Here stood Meshaw's Bookstore, the home of proper propaganda, where all the books came from. Over there was Chock Full Nuts, under the Hotel Teresa, where Malcolm and others came and drank their coffee. On this corner was the African Nationalist Pioneer Movement and Carlos Cook. Next to him on Sundays was Dr. Yosef Ben Yohanan and Dr. Ben. And right here, African Square, is where Malcolm taught and had his unity rallies featuring Adam Clayton Powell, Hewlett Jack, Roy Wilkins, and James Farmer, and others. So it's a whole proliferation of African culture, African Square, African philosophy, African-American collaboration.
It's 1957, and King, a former opponent of nonviolence, is now its leading proponent as figurehead of America's nonviolent civil rights movement. When he appears on TV to describe the difference between nonviolence and pacifism, local whites destroy the transmission tower. The irony is not lost on the Harlems of America.
When I first met him, I was frightened of him. I didn't know what was expected, but he was always, to me, very serious and very focused.
April 14th, 1957. Malcolm's intervention in the now legendary incident involving the arrest and beating of Muslim Hinton Johnson proved just how serious and focused Malcolm could be.
We're standing in the space where there once stood the infamous 28th Precinct, a precinct renowned for its oppression of people in this community. And it was at a precinct where Brother Johnson was brought after refusing to move quickly as he was selling some papers around the corner. And he was beaten up and brought to the precinct, and Minister Malcolm came in and brought several hundred members of the Nation of Islam. And of course, with the dynamics of the community, that warm night, people out of their curiosity came, so much so that you had two elements. You had the Nation of Islam standing tall and erect, quiet, waiting for orders from Minister Malcolm, and you had a frenzied crowd of people in Harlem who were just tired of being pushed around.
Housing in Harlem was overpriced and owned mostly by white absentee landlords. In some flats, you could spend the whole night killing 15 to 20 rats. And the Harlem police were as mean as the rats and the landlords combined.
I was in Chock Full Nuts. I'd just come from the bookstore and was spending some time in Chock Full Nuts around the corner here eating a hot dog. And the brothers came around and were telling me about the frenzy that was taking place around here, but I just ordered some soup. And I was leaving my soup, so by the time I finished my soup and came out, the brothers were coming around the corner. And then they proceed to go up 7th Avenue, 235th Street, and across to Harlem Hospital.
The neurosurgeon that operated on Hinton came out and he told Minister Malcolm that the man would live. At that moment, Malcolm just raised and lowered his hands, and everybody just melted away. I mean, thousands of people without hardly a sound. And the police officer said no man should have that much power.
But that was a night to behold, boy. I'll never forget that, man. It was a night to behold, Harlem was never the same again.
Office memorandum. United States government to director FBI, date July 2nd, 1958. The NYO, that is the New York office, after due consideration, believes that Little should be designated a key figure in view of his extensive activity as minister of Temple No. 7, 102 West 116th Street, New York City.
Mosque No. 7. As-salamu alaykum. 7 syllables.
The movement grew by leaps and bounds because he was very dedicated and he spent a lot of time recruiting and building and the businesses. He built the businesses up. He started a paper. I mean, he worked very, very hard. And there was a lot of animosity towards him, you know. What is he trying to do, kind of thing.
Stridently proclaiming that a white man's heaven is a black man's hell. Tonight we have with us Malcolm X, the Muslim's New York minister, who feels that the Negro must take his destiny into his own hands.
The desegregation decisions and other type of legislation and Supreme Court decisions depends upon changing the white man's mind. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that our own mind has to be changed.
Well, you know, I had been a part of the what I call the Martin Luther King wing of the movement in my college days at Howard University. And by 1962, I had begun to believe that this was just not going, you know, the nonviolent demonstrations and turning the other cheek and that kind of thing. So I was kind of in the middle of things in the summer of 1962 when I moved to Harlem. And the first night I moved in was a Friday evening. Saturday morning, my roommate and I, instead of unpacking, we say, let's walk in Harlem. We were both Southern boys, basically. And this was our first time, you know, being in Harlem. So we walked down Lenox Avenue, and we saw a crowd gathering. And we were told, we asked what was going on, and he said Malcolm X was going to speak. Now, we had heard of Malcolm X. He was the boogeyman.
On Saturday afternoon, there'd be thousands of people all here in the streets. People from 112th, 113th, 115th, 118th that would come. And Malcolm would be talking to the multitude.
There's no such thing as freedom in this country for a black man. There's no such thing as justice in this country for a black man. And there's no such thing as equality in this country for a black man. This is a white man's country.
From the moment I heard that speech, you know, I changed. I literally began to see the real struggle from a real perspective. From a man who I always call a master teacher.
People with wine bottles put them in their pocket. People with cigarettes put them out of the respect and the love for what Malcolm talked about because they recognized that he was a part of them.
Has integration solved the problem or made it worse?
Right here, there would be policemen standing around on the roofs. Malcolm would call them blue-eyed devils and say, look at them crackers, look at them devils. They know what I'm saying is right.
FBI report, June 3rd, 1963. Technical surveillance installed in Malcolm X residence.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad teaches us that the best way to solve the problem is complete separation, that the black man, those of our people in this country who want to have a country of our own where we can go and stand on our own feet and solve our own problems and not have to continue going to court or waiting for some politician to legislate for another 100 or 2 years to prove that we're human beings.
Moderator, I've discussed this with Minister Malcolm before, and
After seeing Mississippi and Alabama close up, I'd be glad to give him those states if it were within my power to do so.
I think we must understand that Malcolm was standing outside of the mainstream of the civil rights struggle, but he wanted desperately to be a part of that mainstream because he loved his people devotedly.
Today they use tricks, and one of the tricks that they've invented is this token integration to get Negro, so-called Negro leaders to accept a few token crumbs of integration that don't solve any problem for the masses of black people in this country whatsoever, but it does make the hand-picked Negroes be satisfied to slow down the cry of the masses.
In his speeches, he opposed what they were doing because that was his doctrine, his dogma, in the Nation of Islam at that time. They wanted separation.
You will never get real freedom and recognition between black and white people in this country without destroying the country, without destroying the present political system, without destroying the present economic system, without rewriting the entire Constitution. It'll be a complete destruction of everything that America supposedly stands for.
The management of the Nation of Islam tended to be bureaucrats, and Malcolm was this great public figure, a charismatic leader, a genius at modern media. Probably in America, anyway, the first great media politician, I think, before white elective officials really caught on to the game. Malcolm figured it out and capitalized on that. That provoked a lot of jealousy among his fellow ministers, but he really was different. He was a public man, they were not.
Malcolm X gradually outgrew the narrow stage of the Nation of Islam. And on the eve of the march on Washington, this was shown in the effect that Malcolm X wanted the nation to participate in this march in 1963, was not given permission to do so.
Now is the time to make real the promises of democracy.
On several dates during February, March, and April of 1963, there were developing feelings of resentment and animosity against the subject, that is Malcolm X, by members of Elijah Muhammad's family.
Now is the time to rise from the dark and desolate valley of segregation to the sunlit path of racial justice.
I was convinced that our Nation of Islam could be an even greater force in the black American man's overall struggle if we engaged in more action.
No, we are not satisfied, and we will not be satisfied until justice rolls down like waters and righteousness like a mighty stream.
Wherever people committed themselves in the Little Rocks and Birmingham's, militantly disciplined Muslims should be there. It could be heard increasingly in the Negro communities. These Muslims talk tough, but they never do anything.
Malcolm X began to see the nation in a broader sense than Elijah Muhammad and other people within the nation. He began to see the mission of the nation as being much larger than the original intent. Malcolm X stopped being just a Muslim leader, and he became a leader in black America.
This is the BBC Home Service. It is with deep regret that we announce that President Kennedy is dead. He was shot down as he was driving in an open car from the city of...
When Malcolm told the press that John F. Kennedy never foresaw that the chickens would come home to roost so soon, Elijah used the incident to silence Malcolm for 90 days. It would soon become clear that behind Elijah's action lay a hidden agenda.
I had discovered Muslims were being betrayed by Elijah Muhammad himself.
During that time, a call came in from Chicago during the time he was silenced. to number 7, Mars. And it was said, they were told to, if Malcolm came back, to give him a job in the restaurant washing dishes. And I told him that that call came in. So he knew he wasn't, there was no way that he could come back.
Elijah Muhammad today faced paternity suits from 2 former secretaries who charged he fathered their 4 children.
I run into some obstacles in the Nation of Islam, and I feel that I can best serve the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's purpose. What I feel, I understand concerning his objectives better on the outside than I can on the inside. And now that I have the independence of action, it's my intention to work with everybody or against everybody, whatever the case may be, to try and get some kind of immediate solution to the problems that are confronting our people.
Well, I wrote to him on quite a few occasions, and I kept hoping I might get an answer, but which I never did. And then on June 6th, he came over to meet the Hiroshima-Nagasaki World Peace Study Mission writers. And when I opened the door, the first thing he said was, "I'm sorry I didn't write. I received all your letters, but if I travel again, I will write to you."
Little, under alias Malik Shabazz, with passport number C294275, departed JFK International Airport. Little has a one-way ticket with itinerary New York to Frankfurt, to Cairo, to Jeddah, Saudi Arabia.
Journey was to Mecca to make myself an authentic Muslim and to give us direct links, direct contacts, direct communication and cooperation with our brothers and sisters all over the earth. So the first step that has been taken, brothers and sisters, since Garvey died, to actually establish contact with our African brothers on the African continent.
One August afternoon, 5,000 miles over Hanoi, an airman came to the awareness that he was dropping bombs on people as dark as himself. He joined the Nation of Islam and returned to Harlem. One day, a group of brothers told him they were having a problem, and could he supply them with guns? The problem was Malcolm, and this brother's name was Gabriel Prosser. I told you to remember the name.
Greetings once again from the cradle of civilization, where the recent African Summit Conference was a tremendous success. Greetings also to your children.
Most significant were the West Africa trips, the meeting with the Organization of African Unity, when he got a pledge from 8 African nations that the problem of the black American would be taken to the United Nations as a human rights problem and not as a civil rights problem.
We're involved in an effort to get the case, the continued mistreatment of Negroes in this country, brought before the United Nations. Our effort is to try and get it recognized not as a Negro problem or a United States problem, but a world problem, a human problem.
He would call me twice a week, telling me where he had hid some money for me. And although as soon as he would leave, I would tear the house up and never find it. And then when I would get a specific letter that would say, look, you know, here and there, under, over, whatever, you know, and I would, of course, just light up, you know. So when he would call, I would be very bubbly, and he said, wait a minute. Is this that you're happy I called? Or is this because you love me? Or is it because you got some money? And, you know, and I would laugh. Of course, I was pleased to get the money, but I would say all of the above. But more importantly, it's because I love you, you know.
Many people in this country who want to see us the minority and who don't want to see us taking too militant or too uncompromising a stand are absolutely against the successful regrouping or organizing of any faction in this country whose thought and whose thinking pattern is international rather than national.
Well, I would say one of the most important things that he brought to the black political outlook is a more global point of view. It's the one thing you don't hear about very much. People tend to concentrate on his nationalism, his views on whites, and how his views on whites changed. But his views about our connections to other blacks really fit within the tradition of progressive black thinkers like Du Bois, who thought that the third world countries and the colonized African countries should go to the UN in 1919. To plead their case.
Greetings from the ancient Valley of the Kings here in Luxor. After 7 weeks amid the archaeological sites of the ancient Nile, I feel like an expert in Egyptology, but I haven't forgotten our own problem there in the States, even for 1 minute, nor neglected it, Brother Malcolm.
In one of his trips there, he told me that he said the way they told him, said, you took this man and substituted him for the real Muhammad. And you created an image that's the same as an idol. And you caused the people to worship that image and come and sacrifice their wealth, sacrifice their money, their daughters, everything to this image that you helped to create. And in Islam, that's one of the uppermost crimes that you can commit. And they said that he would have to pay for that.
On July 5th, 1964, subject Malcolm X was in contact with, and here the name's been taken out, told him that orders to kill Malcolm X came in from Chicago.
If Elijah Muhammad is the leader of the black people in this country, as he professes, then he should be concerned with the brutal treatment that our people are receiving in the state of Mississippi and send his well-trained fruit of Islam down there to protect our people instead of sending them out here in the street to attack former Muslims who don't want to go along with this program anymore.
In 1964, I was told that there was going to be a new black nationalist organization formed by a friend of mine, and she asked me did I want to be a part of it, and I said yes. So it was all very mysterious. She said, I'll call you on Saturday morning at 8 o'clock and tell you what time and where to go. I went to the place where I was told to go. And I had been there about 20 minutes when Brother Malcolm walked through the door. And that was the first time I realized that I was going to be a part of forming an organization that he was involved in. And it just, you know, it was a tremendous, I mean, I sat there and looked. And I was introduced to him for the first time. And then we sat down at this table. And from those meetings, we had several more meetings, we formed the Organization of Afro-American Unity.
We need an organization that no one downtown loves. We need one that's ready and willing to take action. Any kind of action. Not when the man downtown sees fit, but when we see fit. By any means necessary.
Malcolm called me up late in 1964. He then came to my home to discuss it with me, and he brought with him a bodyguard. And I asked him why he brought the bodyguard, if he thought I was going to kill him. Malcolm said, no, Brother James, you're not going to kill me, but there are people after me, and they're going to get me.
Former assistant to Malcolm X at Mosque Number 7 informs him he has been instructed by a mosque official to wire Malcolm's car with a bomb.
He would come and talk with me about what he could see shaping up. And I would tell him, well, why don't you just forget about the whole thing and go on over to Africa or someplace where they'd like to have you and just stay there and let things cool off.
In time, Malcolm will become the unseen guest at the Black Power table. The Black Panther Party will become the spiritual heirs of Malcolm's OAAU. Folks will embrace him as the patron saint of economic self-help. Cultural nationalists will claim him as their fire prophet. But right now, he's fighting for his life.
What has happened, and most Europeans don't realize it, time has changed. And time has changed, the power has changed.
One of the things you noticed about Malcolm instantly on meeting him was his unusual intelligence. This was a fantastic intelligence that learned very swiftly. When he listened to you, you know, he was listening totally if you had anything to say.
And as the people in Africa and Asia get some power of their own, they get a mind of their own.
They start seeing with their own eyes and listening with their own ears and speaking with their own mouth and coming to definitions from their own brain. The European definition now isn't necessarily the definition.
He had met with some of the leading political thinkers and activists in Africa, Kwame Nkrumah, Julius Nyerere, Nasser. He had had long talks with these folk, and he had learned instantly from them that the world was far more complex than the world of Harlem and the inner cities in the United States.
Malcolm remarked that on a radio program in Chicago known as Hotline, John Ali, National Secretary of the Muslims, had been asked by a telephone caller if it was true that the Muslim movement was trying to kill Malcolm X. According to Malcolm, John Ali replied that they were trying to kill Malcolm X and that he should be killed.
I wanted you to know that my house was bombed. It was bombed by the Black Muslim movement upon the orders of Elijah Muhammad. The fire hit the window and it woke up my second oldest baby. But the fire burned on the outside of the house. But had that one gone through that window, it would have fallen on a 6-year-old girl, a 4-year-old girl, and a 2-year-old girl. And I'm going to tell you, if it had done it, I'd taken my rifle and gone after anybody in sight.
The Nation of Islam, by that time, was thoroughly infiltrated. They could not plan a stroll in Central Park without the FBI knowing it. So at the very least, they were aware of plans to assassinate Brother Malcolm, you know, and did nothing to stop it. At worst, they were the puppeteers.
I'm not particularly concerned with how bad it makes me look. My prime concern is to expose it to the fullest of my ability, let the chips fall where they may.
We're at Unity Funeral Home in the Harlem, center of Harlem. And this is also the place where Malcolm was laid to rest prior to his funeral at Child Memorial Baptist Church. Many of us came, myself included, several times to pay our respects and pay homage and reflect upon the life and legend of this man, particularly in his last year. And this funeral parlor has grown to be kind of a landmark because it enhances what we were in life, what we are in life, and what we became from Malcolm's death. And this funeral parlor also, the name of it, Unity, is what Malcolm was about in his last days.
Was no love lost, was no compromise, was no negotiation. I'm telling you, you don't know what our revolution is. Because when you find out what it is, you'll get back in the alley.
While civil rights leaders were talking to the moral conscience of the broad culture, Malcolm was talking to Black people. And I think, in a sense, young people are saying to us, we need somebody to talk directly to us. And then many of us who were around before coming home, because we found that we are also very angry, still realizing we live in a country where a Rodney King incident can happen, where police brutality is probably more widespread than 25 years ago. And we also want within the community to have a dialogue, if not with leadership, with ourselves. But I think the young people, in a sense, are asking for leadership, and they deserve it.
The Voice spoke through albums and tapes. In the 60s, he was privately shared in the households. Now he was loud in the streets.
He was important because he was what the Temi people in West Africa call a truth teller. That they say every 1,000 moons, one is born, and they tell the truth, regardless of the costs. And he told the black people of America the truth about themselves in an unvarnished, ruthless, eloquent manner. He analyzed the situation of the dispossessed blacks, and that analysis is still a valid one. That's why, you know, the memory of him lives the way it does.
We can see today that Malcolm is being resurrected, so to speak, and hopefully it will have a positive effect on our young people, and that they would take this positive side. I mean, I don't know of any negative side that he had, but that they will follow him in terms of search for knowledge and to expand their thinking and to study sciences and academics and prepare themselves for a world to come. And this world is not ruled by ignorant people.